got an email today and brought to mind something that's really critical and super important. It's a super important mantra. I like to call it the filter for life. What I mean by that is, like, anything that is coming at you, whether it's things that you're seeing, hearing, tasting, touching, anything that's about to enter your mind through your senses should pass through this filter. This filter is one of the most important, as I said, mantras, ways of living. It's a filter for what is allowed to come into your life. And that filter is just this one sentence. And I highly advise and recommend people write this down. If you guys have journals, write this down in your journal. The sentence is, does this serve me? It applies to the people you're spending time with. It applies to the activities that you're doing, whether it's sports, driving to work, listening to music. It applies to the type of music you're listening to, the type of movies. It applies to the foods that you consume, that you feed your body with. Does this serve me? It applies to everything in your life. I'm not saying that everything in your life has to serve you, has to be like everything that's coming in through that filter. It doesn't mean that every single thing has to be the best. No. It's okay sometimes we make mistakes, we learn from them. It's okay sometimes to bring in, you know, to have some things that might not be serving our body or our mind or our spirit or our life. That's fine. But it's important to make sure that at least 60% of what's coming into our life serves us. So, you know, I believe in this rule. I guess some people call it the 80-20 rule, or I can't remember. There's so many different beliefs out there, but I believe that being too pure, and you know, what is pure? It's just an idea anyway, but being too pure, you know, isn't necessarily a great thing, isn't necessarily the best thing. You know, in my previous videos, I talk about how for many years, my diet was almost 100% clean, from the air I was breathing, to the water I was drinking, to the foods I was consuming, everything organic, everything, the water I was drinking was, you know, everything. Like, I'm not going to go into too much, but everything that was entering my life, the people, mostly was the diet at that time. And thing is, when you turn yourself into this, of course, all those nutrients and eating well, of course, that's going to help your body become, you know, stronger and healthier and disease-free. But we need the things that stress us sometimes. We need to put some things from our environment, because the environment we live in is not 100% clean, not 100% pure. There's plenty of things out in the world that are designed to hurt us, designed to find weakness. And if I turn my body into this pure, this is my big criticism when it comes to, you know, people who are, you know, I always talk about balance. Balance is important, right? That's what I believe in. I believe in balance. I believe balance is a great religion to have. Be balanced, you know? Being extreme even in your diet, you know? And when we talk about extremism, you know, people think about maybe the negative extremisms, but what about other side of extremism. You know, like, again, I don't want to bash anybody or anyone's way of life, but, you know, being a vegan, in my opinion, I view that as, you know, that's an extreme diet, or even more extreme than veganism is fruitarians. You know, people who just, and I've met some of these people who are, and not surprisingly, the teeth of fruitarians. You know, I've met several fruitarians. One who I met recently was, you know, same as another one I met a couple of years ago. Terrible teeth. Why? Because their belief is that, oh, we should be just feeding off fruit. That's how, you know, our ancestors used to live, you know, I guess all the way back to apes and stuff would just consume fruit. But what they're missing out is that the fruit we have nowadays, it's not how nature intended. The fruit we have nowadays have been heavily bred, you know, what's the word? Crossbred and selected by us. We've picked the sweetest, the biggest, the most colorful, the juiciest, the softest. That's what we've picked. So we'll find a tree, an apple tree, in an apple forest. Now, apple forests are so diverse. So many different types of our apples exist in nature. Why? To protect them from disease, because if one tree gets infected with a certain type of bacteria or disease or whatever, well, it's just maybe representative of 10% of the forest. The rest of the forest is totally different types of apples, totally different species of apples. That's why diversity is so important. And when you limit your anything, whether it's your diet to just fruit, or your way of thinking to just one way of thinking, or your political views to just one way of, you know, looking at things, you're putting yourself in a position of weakness and risk, okay? Being more diverse requires being more open-minded, requires being more open-hearted. Open-hearted as opposed to more fear-based. Being less afraid, you know? Being able to go out of your comfort zone a little bit to diversify, to entertain beliefs that maybe aren't so comfortable or you don't necessarily agree with, or at least just sit and be open-minded and listen. You never know what you're going to learn. The great martial artists of our time diversify as well in their martial arts. They're not just going to stick to one type of martial arts. Otherwise, they're going to get destroyed when it comes to a fight. Even within one style of martial arts, whether it's boxing or wrestling or jiu-jitsu or taekwondo, it's the fighters that are able to diversify their style, you know, and bring ideas from other styles in that are usually more successful and more powerful. So diversification is super important, and going back to extreme views or, you know, what serves you in life. Received an email today, and I'll try to keep this as private as possible, but, you know, I get these sorts of emails and messages every day. You know, this is the primary concern with most people, and they don't realize it most of the time. And what I have a lot of my clients do as one of the first homeworks they'll do is to read through some of their own messages that they've sent to me or emails they've sent to me. Just read through it and identify the thoughts, the beliefs, statements within those emails that they send me that do not serve them. You know, I ask, hey, you know, go through this and you know, highlight all the parts in here, that the beliefs, the thoughts, the statements that don't serve your life. What are the, well, let me quickly go into this, and then I'll talk about what are the things that serve us. What does serve us even mean? okay? Because a lot of people don't understand that. You know, what's good for you? That's a basic thing that a lot of people have difficulty with, is knowing what's good for them. So the email that I received was, it's actually a message, and it's basically full of negative, limiting beliefs, right, from start to finish. And some of the beliefs in here, for example, this person believes that they are dealing with, and this is the part that really stood out for me, was they believe that they're dealing with a lot of ancient ancestral energies, dark energies, I guess, from previous lives, you know, and there's a lot of people who believe in all of that. I'm very open-minded when it comes to that. I'm not going to go into my personal beliefs now. Whatever it is you believe, not saying that that's wrong or right, but this person believes this. This person believes that they have these ancestral dark energies that are almost like, to me, it sounds like they're, you know, haunted by them. Now if you believe that, that's going to affect your life. You've got to ask yourself, does that belief serve me? Does this belief help my life in any way at all? That's all that matters. All right? Are the thoughts that you're having, do they serve you? Again, goes to everything, the people in your life, the activities you're doing, the music you're listening to, but above all, it's the thoughts and the beliefs. Are the thoughts that you're having, are the beliefs that you're having, are they thoughts and beliefs that actually serve your life? All right, that's all that matters. I remember the movie American History X. There was a scene in that movie where the older brother, who's an extreme Nazi, very angry kid, raised by his father, who, you know, had some racist views. This kid winds up turning into a man who winds up leading, a gang, a racist gang in Los Angeles. And there's a scene where there's a counselor, someone who's trying to help him, trying to save him, comes and visits him in prison after he's been gang raped in jail. And he's lying on a bed, and he asks, the counselor asks him, he says, ask yourself if anything that you have done, or, you know, has anything you've done in your life made your life better? Right? And it just hits that guy. Just suddenly wakes up and realizes that everything he's been doing in his life has only made his life worse and the life of the people around him, his family, his loved ones, worse. Now, why is it that that's such an important, you know, awakening statement? Because at our core, at our root level, is our programming, you could say, or our need, or our desire to survive and to flourish, you know, and to influence our community, our world, right? And it's how our species continues to evolve, continues to grow stronger through the ones who are able to survive, reproduce, you know, and then spread what's at their level, what they have reached, spreading their genetic material, you know. So you rise to the top through whatever it is, physical strength, mental strength, social ability, financial ability. You know, nowadays it's a range of so many different things. And when we get to that place, That's when we're supposed to reproduce and make more. You know, someone, I've mentioned this in a lot of my videos, someone like Steve Jobs, you know, really, or it doesn't have to be Steve Jobs, it can be anyone. Anyone who reaches that level technically should be reproducing a lot and then having a lot of strong babies. And there are those babies, you know, some of them are going to rise to the top, some of them are not. But anyway, going back to the core of this video is, I cannot stress how important it is to have this filter in your life. Does this serve me? You meet a new person. You know, you go away. You should ask, you know, does this person serve me? Is this person bringing, you know, good things into my life? And this is a good point now for me to talk about, you know, what does it mean? What does serving me or serving you mean? What does it mean? All right, it's basically, what are the things that energize you, uplift you, inspire you, motivate you, strengthen you, bring confidence into your life, bring peace into your life, bring health, happiness? These are just some of the things that define what serves you. What the opposite, the things that don't serve you. So just to go back a little bit, so those things I just listed, those are signs of things that serve you. If you eat food that makes you stronger, healthier, that's, those are foods that serve you. You know, if they're foods that inspire you, that motivate you, that energize you. Now, I know some of you might be thinking, well, I get inspired and energized when I drink a can of Coke or I have a Big Mac, all right? Okay, that's true. But how do you feel afterwards, after you've had it? That's the question you should be asking, you know? At the moment you're having those things, they're amazing, they're stimulating, but afterwards you'll have the crash from the sugar rush. You'll have that terrible indigestion, or just because you're just, the Big Mac is just designed for your tongue and your eyes because it looks amazing, tastes amazing, but it's just terrible for your health. You know, not good. It doesn't have that many nutrients. It's just difficult to digest. It's taxing your body. So same with the Coke. It's just destroying your sugars is one of the, you know, worst things for your body. And again, I'm not saying that you got to like cut it all out of your body. Absolutely not. Okay, absolutely not. You know, I have a cheat day. You know, I have desserts. I have treats for myself. It's important to balance, have that balance. Remember that, okay? But make sure that more, you know, at least 60% of what's coming into this body, whether it's food, water, air, thoughts, music, movies, make sure that at least 60%, 70% ideally, and even better, 80% of what's coming into your body is what serves you. And remember, yes, okay, well, Coke, cans of Coke, or whatever, alcohol, Big Macs, all of those things, they might excite you, they might motivate you, they might inspire you, but then ask the other questions too that was on that list. You know, do they strengthen you? You know, do they give you more health? You know, so there's a lot of that filter. You're going to build it for yourself. It's the custom-made filter. You're going to allow certain things into your life. And the less toxins, toxic people, toxic music, you know, again, apply the same things. Does this music, does it energize me? Does it motivate me? Does it uplift me? Does it inspire me? Does it make me feel more confident? Does it increase my health, my happiness? How much music out there is depressing? I'm not saying that you should never ever listen to depressing, sad movies or music again, no, but if you're going through a difficult time, you know, whether it's some sort of traumatic experience, a hard breakup, a divorce, a loss, whatever, that's the time when you gotta really adjust your filter so that it's at a more extreme setting, so that you're filling yourself up with more good things. I mentioned this in a lot of my videos, but when you do hit that bottom, when you know, whether it's you've just been crushed by a breakup or a divorce, or, you know, when you hit that bottom, that emptiness, that horrible feeling, you know, rock bottom or wherever, whatever it is, there is so much wealth and power and gold down there. It's almost as if you've drilled all the way down deep into the center of the earth. You've gotten so deep down inside you, drilled all the way down deep, where you're going to start finding things like diamonds. And the thing is that you're going to heal. You're going to heal. You know, you're going to heal. Believe me, you will. It might take weeks, it might take months, it might take years. Some people, it might take many, many years, but they'll eventually heal. I always talk about it's important what shape you heal in. Imagine you've hit the bottom where all the diamonds are. You've drilled, you've gone all the way to the bottom, the core of yourself, where those diamonds are. Well, you're not going to be there for long. So it's so important to absorb and take all of the riches and wealth that are available from that place, because you're not going to be there for very long, especially when you hit the lowest point. You're going to heal. We're always in a state of natural healing. We're always rising. We stop ourselves from rising, but we're naturally in a state of ascension. That's just biologically how we are. We're constantly healing. You cut yourself, it will heal. You have some trauma, mental trauma, someone hurts your feelings or whatever, you'll heal. It's just, that's this gift, this incredible gift that we have, this vehicle, this body, this mind, this spirit, whatever, however you're viewing this, it's an incredible, incredible gift. It's just an incredible thing, and it's just constantly in a state of healing. So once you break down and get down to that bottom, grab those diamonds. What do I mean by diamonds? I'll give you an example of one of the greatest diamonds of all. When you get to the bottom, one of the greatest diamonds is you're going to realize the things that help you and the things that hurt you. Why? Because you've hit rock bottom. So you just cannot tolerate anymore anything that hurts you. You just cannot. You can't. For anyone out there who's been there, who's experienced hitting that rock bottom, you'll understand what I mean. When you get to that place, you're not going to tolerate sad music, depressing people, people who hurt you, foods that are going to make you feel worse. You're not. And if you think that you're at rock bottom, you might not be, if you're able to like wallow in your misery. Because, you know, for example, with just to give you some of my own personal experience, like I was depressed for many, many years, but I was sort of managing it. You know, it's kind of, my depression had become almost like a blanket, you know, like a comfortable blanket. But it wasn't until I really went through some real hard things, you know, and I've been through hard things just as we all have in life. We've all been through our own difficulties. By the way, this is a drink. It's, I don't know if it exists in other cultures, but in Middle Eastern culture, you know, my mom, she's Persian, Iranian, and we call it duk. And duk is basically, it's like a yogurt. It's made with yogurt and salt and mint. And I make it myself now. It's really amazing for my body. I never used to consume it or make it for myself, but it's so refreshing. It's basically yogurt, water, salt, and you can put dried mint or fresh mint. Excellent for your body, for your gut. Because, as you might know, fermented things like yogurt, if you're lactose intolerant, you can use other things that are fermented, but just great for repopulating your lower intestine, your digestive system with good bacteria that will help you to digest foods. Most of our illnesses come from digestive issues. And digestive issues can be fixed. Why have I got some issues right now? Well, unfortunately, you know, most of my life stayed away from antibiotics. The last time I ever took antibiotics was like, can't even remember, 20 years ago. But recently had to do antibiotics. And antibiotics destroys all the bacteria in your body, the good bacteria and the bad bacteria. Sadly, all that good bacteria that over time from eating well, from eating good fermented things. This is a long list of it. I'm not going to get into it. But anyway, cheers. Okay. So yes, going back to things that serve you, super, super, super important, okay? Going back to this email, limiting beliefs, right? So focusing on what you're allowing into your life, what are you believing? So as I say, like one of the homeworks I give people is I say, just go through your own email, go through your own messages and highlight for me all the beliefs that are just not serving you, that are limiting you from reaching your potential, from being happy, from being strong, from being healthy. Oh, I can see a roadrunner outside. They're amazing. Beautiful. Beautiful birds. And they eat rattlesnakes, which is cool. So ask yourself that question, you know. Apply that filter into your life. Activate that filter. Be aware of it. Yes, I'm not going to make out like it's easy. Yes, it's hard. Especially what? The thoughts and beliefs. Especially identifying those. Why? Because those things require awareness. How do we cultivate awareness? Meditating is a great place to start. Or first, you know, go out and learn about it. Learn about how you can strengthen your awareness. I'll be making more videos about it. Awareness comes from observation, sitting, observing, making notes. Okay, and then remember, when you hit that rock bottom, when you hit that place, you know, there's plenty of diamonds to be found there. And one of the diamonds, as an example of a diamond, is you're going to learn what are the things that serve you. What are the things that don't? That's how I learned. And then you make a list. Make a list because we forget. We will forget. And I promise you will be so glad that you journaled, that you made notes of everything while you were in this process. Because, as I said, we're always naturally rising and healing. You're going to be out of this process. This is all going to end. This process is going to end. You're going to go back to your life. Everything's going to be great again. Right? Until the next time, right? Unless you are on this path of continuous self-improvement. And if you are, I take my hat off to you. I salute you. I applaud you. I'm on the same path. We're on the same path as each other. And every day is a opportunity to find out the things that serve you, that don't. Every day is a chance to strengthen your awareness. And the more you become aware of things, especially thoughts and beliefs, the better. This person, for example, is almost like 90% of the people I talk to, not aware that they have all these limiting beliefs. I'm not arguing about the beliefs. I'm not saying that there's no such thing as past lives or there's no such thing as dark energy. I'm not saying any of that. All I'm saying is that ask yourself if these beliefs are helping your life, serving your life. And if they're not, create more distance between yourself and those thoughts, those people, the music, the movies, those beliefs, those statements, the words that you're coming out of your mouth. Create some distance between you, yourself, and those things. Or even better, as I like to say, a more, I think, evolved way to look at it is rather than creating distance between yourself and those things. Instead, focus more on what serves you. I think that's a much more evolved way to look at it, more advanced way to look at it, because if you're focusing on what serves you, then it's going to take care of itself. You're naturally going to create more distance with the things that don't serve you. Okay, I'm going to wrap this up with something, an exercise that is incredibly empowering, and I hope that you'll have some time to do it. This is one of the basic things that I have a lot of the people that I work with do. I do this myself. I have these lists. These lists are important for my life. Every day I have them. I look at them, you know, just to make sure I'm hitting these lists. Three lists. Write them down in your journal. Super important. Go do them today. All right, start on them today. And it's not that you're going to do these lists and that's it. No, you're going to like work these lists almost like a clay sculpture over time. You're going to get things out of that list, add more things, edit, refine, mold. These lists are life, and they're going to be your Bible. They're going to be your anchor of health and happiness. List number one, write down a list of all the life goals you have, all of your goals in life, whether it's short-term goals, maybe to run a marathon or to, for me, like I want to be able to do 20 pull-ups in one shot. So far I'm at around 11, you know, so that's a short-term goal, or long-term goals, you know, like for me, I would like to make a movie one day. I'd like to, you know, record a new album, you know, write a book possibly, you know, so these are my goals, yeah? So write a list of all your life goals, short-term goals, long-term goals. Number two, write a list of all the things, the activities that serve you, the things that you enjoy, that make you feel great. Just some of the things off my list. I've done a video on this, so you can go check it out if you want. All the things that make me feel great, I think is what it's called. And this list should have things like, you know, for me, like I'll just read some of the things off my list. You'll be surprised. It's stuff that, things that make me, that serve me, that make me feel better, you know, especially when I feel like crap, I come to this list. When I feel empty, alone, depressed, anxious, angry, whatever. Whenever I feel like crap, I'll look at this list and I'll scan down the list. And yes, maybe not all of these things are going to be what I'm in the mood for at that time, but I might find one or two that will be like, ah, yes, I can do that. So from my list has things on there like cleaning my house. I feel great after I do that. Or having a hot shower. You know, for me, showers are like a new beginning. It's like a baptism, like a meditation, you know, gardening, exercise, push-ups, going on drives or rides. You know, I like to just go for a drive or a ride. It's just fun. I enjoy it. It helps me feel better. Connecting with my family, with my mom or my father or my brother. Writing affirmations, drawing, painting. All right, so that's list number two. Those are just some examples from my own personal list. So write a list of all the things that make you feel better. You know, I had one of my clients do this the other day, and in there he put sex, you know, having sex. Now, I'll let you all decide about that one. I think yes and no, right? It depends, all right? Obviously, you're not going to put heroin on that list. Why? Because, yeah, those things make you feel great for a short period of time. How do you feel afterwards? That's what's important. Remember what I was talking about earlier in the video. So knowing what serves you is important. Okay? So sex isn't on my list. Yes, I love sex. Sex is incredible. But it's got to be, you know, it depends. There's different types of sex. If it's something that strengthens your life, you know, makes you feel better afterwards, brings confidence, improves your self-image of yourself, the way you see yourself, if you feel great after it, those are important. Self-love, yeah. Self-love means how you view yourself. Do you love yourself? Do you respect yourself? Confidence comes from self-love, comes from respecting yourself, when you love yourself, when you have a good value, view yourself highly, not in an arrogant way, just, you know, you view yourself, you're content with yourself, you're at peace with yourself. Okay, the third list, write a list of 20 things that you're grateful for in life. Okay, so go ahead and start on those lists. And let me know how you guys feel afterwards. And keep those lists handy. I have copies on my computer, on my phone, in my journal. You know, these lists, once you write them all down, your list of goals, your list of activities in life that you love and enjoy, and list of things to be grateful for. That is your life. You're putting your life somewhere to see. You'll be able to see. And then what you do is, those, every thing on that list is like a seed, right? Those are seeds. And you're going to water those seeds with your attention, okay? Your attention, your power, as I always say, attention is power. Your attention, your power, is like water for those seeds. Whatever it is, the goals, the activities, the gratitude. Whenever you put your attention on those things, whatever they may be, you're going to water them. And as you water them, they're going to grow. As they grow, what happens? They'll turn into trees. As they turn into trees, they'll start to give you fruit. And if you're smart, and you stagger all these, and you have many goals, many activities, diversify, as I was talking about earlier with the apple farce, diversify. Don't just have one activity or two, or one life goal or two. Have as many as you can. I'm not saying that in a way that you're going to be lost and not focused. No, always focus on, you know, maybe a handful, but have backup ones too. Because what you're going to find is, as you give your attention to, let's say for me, I'll give my attention to music or coaching or jiu-jitsu or martial arts. As I water those things with my attention, those things grow, they develop, and then they start to give back. They'll give me fruit, right? But then I can start watering the other backup goals, like, oh, one day I want to make a movie. So give that a little attention every day. Maybe think about it in bed. Oh, what's the movie going to be about? Or if I'm going to think about my album, what are the song titles going to be? What's the album cover going to be like? What's it going to sound like? I'm just in bed thinking about it, but my attention is watering, giving water to those goals. And those goals are starting to bloom in my head. And that's very similar to the laws of attraction, manifesting. What you think about, you know, it's going to become manifested. And if you play it smart, you'll always have fruit coming from all your life activities, from your ability to be grateful. Gratitude, so important. So those three lists, you know, as you put your attention on gratitude, you'll see the results. You'll see the fruit of happiness come into your life. You'll be grateful for more. You'll enjoy more as you put your attention, your water, your power onto the activities in life that you enjoy. You're going to see the fruit from those things. You're going to feel energized, inspired, alive, you know. As you put your attention, your power onto your life goals, the same thing will happen. With each of these things, with your goals, with your activities, come with it a huge world of people, activities, events, books. So don't look at it as just one seed. A seed is an incredible thing. All you do is add water, which is your attention, and then just allow it to grow. All right? So sending everybody out there all the very best. And remember, the point of this video is to establish and activate that filter in your life by which everything that enters your life goes through. And that filter is, does this serve me?